Okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Yao. I'm a staff scientist at the Dr. Andrew Seuss Lab in School Research, La Jolla campus. Yes, we do have another campus in Jupiter, Florida. Those campuses are very beautiful, and we welcome your visit. Today, I'm going to talk on my environment.info. It's a high-performance API for variant annotations. So this is our index page. Very modern, yeah. You can find the links to the docs, news, and our other BioSynth APIs on the left side panel. Please remember our green logo. And this is the query interface. You can span the arrow and play it around. Okay, next. With this simple query interface, we can get annotation for a specific variant identified by its HVS ID or SID, for example. Like the first query is going to pull all the annotation for this variant on chromosome 6. And the response is like using the JSON format on the right. From the example response, we can see that we combined multiple data sources of annotation. And if you're only interested in certain, then we can append a fields parameter like we did in the third query. It's like say, hey, I'm only interested in deep SNP and clean raw annotation. Okay, so then you get a simplified response. Also, we can fetch variants for all the fetch annotations for all the variants matching the query terms. So in the fourth query, we got a Q equal to CDK7. That means fetching all the variants associated with gene CDK7. The query return syntax is supported by Elasticsearch query DSL. So we can leverage some high-level operator like and underscore exists in the last query. It means find all the variants associated with the gene CDK7, and second, having a solid dense score from the DBN SFP data source. All the queries listed here are GET queries. We also support the post HTTP methods for batch queries. Also, please refer to our document for more like query parameters like the fields and the more query return syntax like and this. Okay. From the response, we can see that we have like multiple data sources of annotation. For HG19 variants, we have 19, and for HG38 variants, we have 9. All the responses are in the JSON standard JSON format. Next, I'm going to talk about how my run.info is built and how we make it highly scalable. So we have a so-called BioSynth tech stack with BioSynth SDK as the cornerstone for all the BioSynth APIs like MyGene, MyVariant, MyCAN, and MyDisease. We also have BioSynth Studio as a management tool for each API. We also provided downstream knowledge discovery tools like Smart API and BioSynth Explorer. Okay, as a typical BioSynth API, Maven.info has a architecture like this, kind of complex, okay. But first, each data source is introduced by a plugin. So a plugin's job is to download or dump in our term, the data files and parse the data file into a bunch of JSON documents. And later the collection of JSON documents will be uploaded and merged into a MongoDB storage. The MongoDB is a NoSQL storage for flexible structured data like JSON document here. And the next step would be indexing the collection of JSON document into Elasticsearch. So Elasticsearch is a widely used search engine. We chose it as the core of our query interface. So the plugins, MongoDB and Elasticsearch, make the backend of one BioSense API. And for the front end, we have a Tornado instance to receive the HTTP requests. So Tornado is a lightweight HTTP server application. We chose it to interpret and delegate the requests to the underlying Elasticsearch client that further access our underlying Elasticsearch instance and return the response. So what's the role of BioSense SDK here? We can think of BioSense SDK to perform all the actions here. So the SDK would run the dumping, parsing, uploading, merging, etc. jobs. So we can think of BioSense SDK as the skeleton of one BioSense API, and the data and the storage like the flash and blood. You can we published BioSense SDK to Pure API, and you can pip install it and try publish your own APIs. Okay, so next let's take a look at the structure of the plugin. A simple plugin can be manifest based. So we can only in this example plugin we have one parser module, parser.py here, and a manifest file. Its main job is to indicate download link to the data file and a pointer to the parser module and the parser function. You know, manifest-based plugin, the dumper and uploader will be the default BioSense SDK classes, but you can also customize this by subclassing, making an advanced plugin like this one. So please refer to our developer guides to see how to implement the plugin on your own. Okay. Next, I'm going to introduce BioSense Studio. It's a web-based management panel for each BioSense API. So this index page of BioSense Studio for mybrain.info, it lists all the recent updates in data sources. And in this grid panel, we can run all the plugin tasks like dumping, parsing, and uploading, et cetera. For each data source, and the exclamation mark here indicates something's off and calls for the developer's attention. Okay, before I talk about the scalability issues, I'm going to illustrate the flexibility in our BioSense API architecture. So each major component of our BioSense API can be distributed across the network. For example, in this deployment, we can have the API code and MongoDB running on server number one, and the Elasticsearch node running on server number two, and all the front end running on server number three. So this in reality, these major components are connected by a configuration files. So the separation make it easy to scale up or scale out any individual components. Say, hey, I want to scale up the electric nodes. We can replace server number two with a more powerful workstation. Or if you want to scale out it, we can replace server number two with a cluster of workstations. And from our experiences, the performance bottleneck is often in the Elasticsearch node. So we introduce a cloud feature to quickly publish and restore the Elasticsearch indices within the backend. So for example, in this architecture, we can have an internal Elasticsearch node on server number one. So only job is to make a copy of the snapshots here. And push the snapshot to the Amazon S3 cloud, and later restore the snapshot to the reals to the real serving Elasticsearch node on server number two. So this way, yeah, it's the same. We can scale up scale out server number two very easily, and at the same time leaving server number one, server number three untouched. Okay, here are some screenshots about the snapshots features. Like we can make a copy, make a snapshot here, and publish to S3 and install it to another server. And here is a Amazon S3 interface of our current MyVariant API. Okay, we are very proud of MyVariant Info because we believe we follow the best practice to build an API. It's very comprehensive. Like we combined multiple data sources of annotation. And currently we have over 1.4 billion documents for each assembly. And this API is very simple to use. You can do web APIs, you can use clients in Python, R, and JavaScript. And advanced HTTP methods are also supported, like the message pack, gzip, etc. And all the responses are in standard JSON format, making it very easy to integrate with other services and APIs. We aim to do monthly updates on the data sources if there's no significant change to the code base. We manage to make it low latency, and we provide freedom to request specific data. Imagine make it highly scalable, like we just discussed before. Currently, we receive like 3 million requests on average each month from 2,000 unique IPs. Yeah, we make it almost running all the time. At the same time, we are actively supporting the academic community. So here, as an example, Civic API has integrated myvariant.info for the CVF annotations here on their website. Besides Civic, we also have like MyGene2, CleanGene, et cetera, as our consumers. I think we can deal with all the dirty jobs of data for our consumers and making them focus on their own research of interest. And also please let us know if you would like to cooperate with us. At last, I want to thank my PIs, Dr. Andrew Su and Dr. Jonae Wu, and all the other team members in research. Also, we deeply appreciate the funding support from NIH. Thank you.
Thank you, Ariel. So we can have some questions. Any questions? Okay, so I have one question about, so I'm so impressed with the backend structure of the MyVariant.info and also the BioSyncs API thing. And I think these kind of very essential API systems need to have a very stable operations in the long term, right? Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And then you said that you're using the Elasticsearch and then MongoDB, yeah. But how do you think, if it's feasible to replace those database products if you needed to, you know, let's say, so for example, Elasticsearch has now a license problem, right? And then AWS needs to switch the Elasticsearch to the new one. So if that kind of the things happen, do you think if it's possible to replace these things?
That's a good question. Internally, we also support SQLite 3 as another internal method. But for Elasticsearch, currently we don't have any alternative to it. But I think we can switch to any other search engine application if the license issue happened. Currently, we try to make abstract layers in our application that has some high level interface towards any common types of search engine. So in the future, we can switch between different types of storage application and search engine applications. Yeah.